Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I have the pleasure to open this plenary session. And I will start with a reminder from the housekeeping. The coffee break this morning is after the oral sessions from 10:30 to 11 a.m. upstairs in the exhibit halls. I have the honor to introduce the plenary speaker of this morning, Michael Benedikt from CERN, the European Organization for Nuclear Research. Michael Benedikt has been working for more than 20 years at CERN. He has been involved for a long time on the operation of accelerator at CERN, the booster and the PS machine. He was in charge of the construction of the Medaustron synchrotron machine for medical applications. And he is today the project leader for the FCC, the Future Circular Collider Machine. He will talk about the FCC, the High Energy Collider, and I have the pleasure to introduce him and to call him for the talk. Thank you, Michael.
Thank you very much, Amalia. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great pleasure for me to be here and to be able to present to you this overview on the Future Circular Collider study and on the High Energy Collider in particular. Now, I'm myself, as you just heard, not from the field of superconductivity, so don't expect details in that area. But what I want to do is I want to talk a little bit about history of colliders, about the existing machine, the LHC, and its upgrade to the HLLHC project. And then I want to focus and give you an overview on the parameters and on the main components and layout of this future circular collider study. And then, of course, I want to mention explicitly the different areas where superconductivity plays a major role in these future colliders. So first, I would like to thank very much the ASC Program Committee for having invited me to give this talk and for the opportunity to present to this audience the FCC study. And then I should say the FCC study, I will come back to that later, is organized as a large international collaboration. So the things and the plans that I will show you during my talk rely, of course, and are based on the efforts of many different people that collaborate under the FCC umbrella, and I would like to particularly thank several colleagues that are listed on this slide that have provided slides and detailed input for this presentation, and they were also available for detailed discussions. So let me now start with a few words on high energy accelerators and colliders. So in a very general way formulated, we are using electrical fields, which we call then RF cavities, the environment where these fields are controlled. And we use magnetic fields in form of accelerator magnets to guide, accelerate, and collide charged particle beams. Usually we do this with electrons and positrons, or with protons, or even with the antiparticles of proton, the antiproton. Now, this is the very basic principle of an accelerator, and we have built these machines now since about the 50s, the colliders of the 50s of the last century. And we are aiming to increase the energies of our machines all the time. And I would like to give you the two reasons for why we are doing this in high energy physics. So you all know the Einstein equivalency principle of mass and energy, the E equals mc squared. And our interest in the collisions is to free or make available kinetic energy and to use this kinetic energy to produce particles with high masses. And as you can see from the formula on the slide, if we want to produce a higher mass, we need to provide higher energies. So this is one of the main approaches, and the second approach in high energy physics is that we can look at the substructure of particles with smaller and smaller wavelengths. And there's the De Broglie formula that relates energy and wavelengths of a particle in the wave-particle dualism, as you know. And there the lambda, the wavelength, is inversely proportional to the energy of a particle. So this means, again, the higher the energy of our beams, the smaller the corresponding wavelengths, and the finer the resolution that can be achieved if we want to look into matter and substructure of matter. So these are the two driving terms. Once we can increase the height, the energy of a collider or of an accelerator, we can increase its potential for discoveries. Now let's look at the machines that have been constructed in the past and are to some part still being in operation. You see there's a large number starting from end of 50s, 60s, last century, with the last machine that came up into operation being the LHC. And now we can look into those machines that rely in one form or another on superconductivity. And here I have marked now those that operate with a large-scale supercolliding RF system. Then we can mark those that are relying on a large superconducting arc magnet system. And then we have the last group that uses radio frequency and magnet systems based on superconductivity. So what you can see from this plot is that essentially all machines that came up from the late or from the beginning of the 80s, apart from the SLC, are based in one or more areas on superconductivity. And this shows the importance of the field of superconductivity in general for accelerators and in particular for high energy colliders. Now, with these different machines, of course, also different discoveries came along. And I put down the most relevant for the explanation and for the understanding of the standard model of particles here. So the Spear machine found the charm and the tau lepton. Later, the Petra machine, the gluon, so the force. Then on the SPPS, a proton-antiproton collider at CERN, the bosons were found, the W and the Z bosons. The Tevatron discovered the top quark, and the zoo of particles of the standard model was completed with the discovery or with the experimental verification of the Higgs boson at the LHC in 2012. So we can say from this plot that colliders are very powerful instruments for developing and increasing our understanding of nature, and they are very important for particle discoveries and for precision measurements. Now, allow me a few more words or sentences on the LHC. Here on the slide, you see the data that were taken by the CMS experiment concerning the Higgs boson discovery. And on the horizontal axis is the mass of these particles. And on the vertical axis, you have the number of events. And you see there is a huge number of events and statistics and measurements necessary until this small, tiny signal that you can see develops out of this background. That is the reason why we have to build colliders that can generate many, many events. So a very high interaction rate in the collision points to generate a lot of statistics and to have enough information to really detect new particles or new phenomena. And for this discovery, the Nobel Prize was awarded then in 2013 to Englert and Higgs, who constructed the underlying theory already in the 60s of the last century. Now, this is now a plot from today's operation from the LHC to show you how the performance of the machine has increased from year to year. The years 2011 and 2012 were operation at 3.5 and 4 tera electron volt, and the years 2015-2016 were operation at 6.5 tera electron volt beam energy. And if you look at the present performance, which is the magenta curve here on this slide, you see that the number of events that can be generated and the corresponding integrated luminosity has reached the design level of this machine. And now the effort is, of course, focusing on the analysis of all these data. So far, there are not yet signs for any deviation from standard model physics. So, this means with this Higgs discovery, we have completed our understanding of the standard model. However, the main problem or the difficulty that high energy physics is faced with is clearly the fact that this standard model and all the observations that we have describe only about 5% of the universe. And then there are many other open questions that we need to answer or need to tackle to have a better understanding of the situation. This is the question of dark matter and dark energy. Dark matter is manifesting itself on pictures or measurements like the one that you see on the right-hand side of this slide. This shows rotation curves of stars close to galaxies. And based on the masses that we associate or that we can measure for these galaxies, we would expect certain rotation speeds and rotation curves of these particles. And what we observe in reality is different movements, and the different movement can only be explained using our present understanding by masses that are present in the universe and that distort the observed movement that we cannot understand and not see at this stage. And to answer all these questions, one potential route is via high energy accelerators, and that's why we are strongly pushing this field to evolve further. And clearly, the first step that we have to take here is to fully exploit the LHC machine that is already in operation, and that's why we are upgrading the LHC to the so-called high luminosity phase. High luminosity means simply more events per time unit generated, and the goal is here to gain a factor of 5 in instantaneous collision rate, and in total a factor of 10 in integral collisions recorded up until the end of the lifetime of the LHC towards 2035, 2037. So this project is called High Luminosity LHC. It's an ongoing project. Most of the modifications to the LHC are taking place close to the two main experiment points. This is the point 1 and 5 that you can see here, marked in red on this layout, and then some smaller modifications on certain points along the beamline. Now, in the framework of this project, there will be about 100 new superconducting magnets that will go into the machine, out of which 36 are large niobium-13 magnets. There will be new powering links that will be superconducting. There will be HTS current leads to bring the power from the power converter to the magnets. There will be new cavities. There are some modifications to tunnel infrastructures and tunnel galleries in the underground. And there are, of course, to the new superconducting magnets and new infrastructure, linked are some new and upgraded cryoplants. Looking into this in a bit more detail is on this slide. So there will be new niobium-13 quadrupoles built, and these serve to produce very high quadrupole fields, which in turn allow a very strong focusing of the beam towards the experiment points. So this means we can make the cross-section of the beams when the beams collide inside the experiment smaller, and due to the smaller cross-section, the probability for collisions is higher and the event rate goes up. Another area is niobium-13 dipoles. This is 11 Tesla dipole magnets that will be built to replace with this higher field very few of the existing 8 Tesla dipole magnets, hereby gaining a little bit of space to put new instrumentation into the machine. So this is a very important step, also in view of the future circular collider, because it is the first time that we are building and that we will put niobium-13-based magnets into an accelerator. So it's a very important step also for future projects that envisage using the same magnet technology. Then I mentioned already MGB2-based links will be fabricated for the LHC upgrade to power this new quadrupole magnet arrangement and some other new magnets in these areas. And there will be some very special cavities. They are called CREP cavities, and these cavities are superconducting again, but they are built from bulk niobium. So these are the major ingredients to the upgrade of the high luminosity LHC, and with this upgrade, we hope to understand better and learn more about the physics beyond the standard model. And of course, as a second goal, we want to deepen the understanding and the knowledge about the Higgs particle and its properties. Now, the second step following this high luminosity LHC upgrade is then towards future high energy colliders. And here there are different approaches. I would very briefly introduce the different options that are being studied. We have linear electron-positron colliders. There are two versions, click compact linear collider and ILC, the international linear collider. These can cover center of mass collisions energies of up to a maximum of about 3 tera electron volt. And then there is the group of circular colliders. And here there are two variants, either a lepton or a hadron collider. The lepton colliders are strongly limited in the maximum energy that they can reach because of the synchrotron radiation that these particles emit when they are at high energy on a circular trajectory. And there's the second group, that is the proton colliders, and this is the group that, to our present understanding, can by far reach the highest possible energies in collision. At the moment, on the accelerator physics front, we do not see, on the time scale of the next few decades, any other accelerator concepts that would allow to reach the 50 to 100 TeV center of mass collision energy range than circular hadron colliders. And in my further talk, I will focus on these circular hadron colliders. So here's just an overview on these machines. So on the right-hand side, you see all these studies and these proposed projects and their collision energies and the typical year where they could go into operation. You see the first time such a machine could be built would be somewhere 2030 onwards. And the FCC high energy collider is aiming at this 100 TeV, center of mass collision energy, that would then allow direct production of particles with masses up into the 10 TeV or a few 10 TeV mass scale range. And at the same time, it will enable very high reaction rates and very high precision measurements of the known standard model particles and the standard model physics. So this future circular collider study was initiated at the beginning of 2014 following a request that was stated by the European Strategy for Particle Physics. This is a European-wide highest level political scientific consultation process that takes place every 5 to 6 years, comparable to the SNOMAS process in the US, that defines a roadmap for the particle physics in Europe. And in this strategy update 2013, there was a request to CERN to organize a global study for a future high energy circular collider. So in the scope of this study is, and the whole study is driven by this proton-proton collider, this superconducting machine that should be based on a magnet technology in the order of 16 Tesla field level. It should provide collision energy of 100 tera electron volt in an infrastructure of about 100 kilometers circumference. So inside the study is of course also the infrastructure. And since such a large tunnel can be used also for other collider scenarios, there is also included the study of a lepton collider, an electron positron machine that could possibly go into such a tunnel in a first stage if there are reasons from the physics side or other to take this way. I would also like to mention here that, of course, there exists an option at CERN to replace the existing LHC machine with a machine that is based on a new magnet technology, on the same magnet technology, in fact, that we are mentioning here. And this is what we call the high energy LHC. And this is an option that is also included in the future circular collider study. So let me just very briefly remind you of the overall scope that we have to cover until 2018 to come up with this conceptual design report. We need to have a design, a basic design, and we need to prove the feasibility of the accelerator concepts. We need to launch R&D on the key enabling technologies. And here I want to mention explicitly, of course, the 16 Tesla magnet technology and also the radio frequency acceleration technology. These are essential technologies that must be mastered and that are very basic ingredients for such colliders. Then included is also a design of the tunnel infrastructure and of the surface infrastructure. This case will be, of course, site-specific because this scenario will be linked to the existing CERN accelerators and CERN machines. And then on the physics side, we need to elaborate and we need to document also the physics cases, the physics opportunities, and the discovery potential that we are associating with these machines. We have to understand and sketch and develop the experiment concepts for the large detectors for all the different machine options. And we, of course, need as input for the next strategy decisions a basic understanding of the cost, of the feasibility of the organization concepts for such very large-scale future projects. So here I would like to set now this future study in context, schedule-wise, with the operation and activities of the high-energy accelerators at CERN. So if you look at the middle timeline here, LHC operation run 2, this is what we are presently doing. So we are taking data for physics at the collision energy of 6.5 and 6.5 TeV. And in parallel, we are having an upgrade project. This is the high luminosity LHC project that I just mentioned that started with the first design in 2005 and is now in the construction phase and will be implemented in basically in two longer shutdowns from 2019 and 2020 and 2024-25. It should be fully implemented by the end of 2025. And then we would have operation in this upgraded phase from 25 for about 10 years to 2035, 2037, when the, let's say, natural end of life of the LHC would be approached. And this is about 20 years from now. Yeah? We have 2016. And of course, in order to provide a new interesting infrastructure to the field, we should have an answer and an option for the continuation of high energy physics research at the energy frontier by, let's say, 2040. And this is the timeline goal for the planning for the future circular collider study. We are now in the design phase that will finish 2018-19 with a conceptual design. Then we would go into a more technical design phase that should see technical design report and prototyping activities. Then would be a natural start or an earliest natural start of construction at the end of the high luminosity LHC implementation phase, which is 2025, 2026. And then there would be civil engineering. In parallel, there would be industrialization of technical components and then technical component production with the aim to start machine installation at the earliest in 2030, 2032, and to bring the project to a completion by 2040, with the start of operation. This is a rough timeline. Now to do this, we are focusing on the different areas and of course a high priority is given to the infrastructure studies that are preparing the ground for these activities. Here you see the presently preferred variant on the top middle picture. This is a top view of the Geneva Basin. You see the Lake Geneva coming in from the middle of the picture on the top side. So this new tunnel would cross the lake at some minus 150 meter depth, and it would go around Geneva and around the Salève mountain that is located just behind Geneva. And as you see, it is linked with the LHC and with the CERN infrastructure. This is the smaller red circle that you see on the top. And we have found solutions for civil engineering that you can see from the bottom line that shows the tunnel in the geological structure in this basin. Where we can remain with the tunnel into the most, in the best suited geological structures in the Geneva Basin that minimize the risk for tunneling. So in conclusion from these studies, a circumference of 90 to 100 kilometer fits very well this geological environment. It can be made in such a way that the LHC can be used as the injector. And now we're going in more detail on this study. Here, one slide on the injector considerations. I should say that such a large machine requires, such a large and high energy machine requires a pre-injector chain. The analogon that I'm usually using is that of a gearbox in a car. Yeah? If you want something to drive very fast, usually you don't do it with a single gear. You need a gearbox and you switch 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. With each gear, you have a certain velocity range that you can cover. And it's not very different in accelerators. With each machine, we have a certain momentum range that we can cover. And if we want to get to very high momenta, we need an injector chain. Of course, an injector chain is a costly adventure if you need to build it from scratch. And it was always one of the big strengths and assets of CERN over the last 60 years, say, that the existing accelerators were always used as infrastructure for the next higher energy step to come. And in this case, the proposal is exactly the same. One would try to reuse the existing infrastructure, including the LHC, injecting from the LHC into the new machine. And alternatively, there's one variant that is, again, of big interest on the superconducting magnet side. The alternative could be a machine that injects at slightly lower energy from a newly to be constructed SPS machine using the existing tunnel but replacing the SPS with superconducting magnets. This could be magnets in a field range of 6 to 7 Tesla, fast ramped with a ramp rate of around 1 Tesla per second. So also a very interesting option that we will pursue in some more detail. Here, see a little bit more details on the tunnel layout. You see the 100 kilometer tunnel with about 6 meter diameter. And then the red boxes and the red shafts are those that are foreseen for experiment location on this ring. So they are associated with large underground caverns that would need to be built. Then there are some more 8 service caverns for infrastructure that is necessary to operate the accelerator. In total, there are 12 plus 4 large vertical shafts, which make a total integral length of about 3 kilometers on shafts. 2 transfer tunnels to link to the existing machines of about 10 kilometer integral, and 2 beam dump tunnels to dump the beam from this very high energy collider in a safe way at the end of each operation run of 4 kilometers length. So you see it's a massive infrastructure project that is being studied here. Now, let me show a slide with the parameters of the Hadron Collider. We are aiming here at the collision energy of 100 TeV to be compared to the LHC of 14 at the moment, so nearly one order of magnitude. You have to understand in a circular accelerator, the energy that you can reach is linked to the product of bending field in the bending magnets and radius of the accelerator, because we have to keep our particles on track. And if we want to win with respect to the LHC about one order of magnitude, we are trying to do this here by increasing the magnetic field by a factor 2, so going from 8 to 16 Tesla, and by increasing the radius by a factor 4, going from 25 to 100 kilometers of circumference. And this gives a factor 8, which is very close to the desired order of magnitude. I want to bring your attention also to the last 2 lines on this parameter list. This is the stored energy per beam, so this is a very high value here. You see 8.4 gigajoule will be inside each beam, just to give you a handy comparison. This is about the kinetic energy of an Airbus A380 that has 560 tons when it takes off, when it reaches its traveling speed of 750 kilometers an hour. So it means each beam is equivalent to having such an Airbus circulating in this 100 kilometer tiny vacuum tube. And of course, we need to land this beam at the end of operation in a safe way somewhere outside the accelerator tunnel. And we have to handle this object during the operation phase. So This means that a lot of efforts and a lot of conceptual design efforts have to go into the direction of safety, safe operation and beam handling for these machines. I will have one small example for the beam handling related to superconducting principles. And the last line here is also important. This is the synchrotron radiation. These particles, the proton, will emit synchrotron radiation when they are on their curved trajectory, and they are on their curved trajectory in the middle of the superconducting magnets. And the superconducting magnets will, of course, be at a very low temperature. So this synchrotron radiation that is emitted, it's 30 watt per meter per beam, will in principle be deposited in the middle of the cold mass and have to be extracted. I will come back to that problem later. Since we don't talk about physics, I put a slide in with a link to a large physics report. This is a several hundred pages report that outlines and summarizes our present understanding of the discovery potential of the physics of such a large machine. And now let's go a little bit more into the technical aspects and the main magnet options and requirements. So here you see the Geneva Basin, you see the ASC that is 27 kilometer long based on 8.3 Tesla niobium titanium magnets, and there's about 1,300 tons niobium titanium in these coils. For the upgrade that I mentioned to a high energy machine, so replacing these 27 kilometer or the 20 kilometer magnets with higher field magnets, 16 Tesla magnets, we estimate that we would need about 2,500 tons niobium 13 as conductor material. If we look at the future circular collider, baseline is the 100 kilometer machine again with the same magnet technology of 16 Tesla. We estimate 10,000 tons of niobium 13 necessary to build this magnet. And then just to compare, we've also looking or sketched a variant that is maybe a longer term variant to understand what would be the impact if 20 Tesla magnets were available. And then of course this 100 TeV collision energy could be achieved in an 80 kilometer infrastructure. We would need here 2,000 tons of HTS insert into about 8,000 tons of LTS magnets that would provide basic field level of 14, 15 Tesla. But the focus is clearly on the baseline development, and the baseline means the 16 Tesla niobium 13 magnet technology. Now here, just to put this into hard figures in terms of unit numbers for the different magnets, on the LHC we have 1,232 dipoles of about 15 meter length, and on the FCC, on the 100 kilometer machine, we would have slightly more than 4,500 dipole magnets, again of 15 meter length each. Each magnet would have a stored energy of 44 megajoule, so a large stored energy in the whole chain here. Quadrupole magnets, 390 magnets on the LHC, 760 magnets on the FCC, so very large numbers and of course associated long production time, and we need to develop strategies in the course of the process of the project on how such numbers of magnets can be produced with industry worldwide in a cost-efficient and in a risk-controlled way. Now, to put all this in place, we have set up a technology program that should provide the basic for building these magnets. So the first ingredient is a strength development and procurement program to reach the specifications required for such 16 Tesla magnets. Then a wound conductor program. That should be a program to understand mechanical aspects and aspects related to the construction, to the stresses in such high field magnets in simplified compact setup that would allow testing on a very short turnaround time in comparison with tests of full coils or full models. Now this should then be complemented by work in the required field range starting as soon as possible. And here we see two routes. One is 16 Tesla enhanced racetrack model, and then with an aperture or with a cavity, 16 Tesla racetrack model magnets. And then these steps would be followed in the more longer term with 16 Tesla demonstrator production from 2021-22 onwards. Now, the material investment that we have foreseen at this stage to go into these activities is about 15 million Swiss francs, out of which half roughly goes into the conductor development program. And this, I think, is fully justified because it's very clear that niobium-13 is here one of the main factors for the feasibility, for the quality and for the cost in the end, and for the performance of these magnets, and it deserves to be given highest attention. Now, on this graph, you see the in blue, the presently available high luminosity LHC wire. And for the FCC magnets, we require at 16 Tesla, 4.2 Kelvin, a current density of 1,500 amps per square millimeter, so roughly an increase with respect to the presently available wire of about 50%. And this, of course, in order to limit the coil cross sections and in order to limit the overall amount of conductor that is needed to build the 100 kilometer of this machine. And this development, we're trying to set this up as a global activity involving institutes, partners worldwide from the very beginning. So this has different steps. First step is, of course, to procure the state-of-the-art conductor for this enhanced racetrack model and so on, and for other prototyping activities from Bruker and from OST, so in Europe and the US. And then we want to stimulate beyond this the development of conductor with industry worldwide. So for this, there's a collaboration aiming at a Japanese contribution with CERN KEK. There is a collaboration with Bochwa for a Russian contribution and involving Russian industry. There is an industrial collaboration set up with Korea, and there's an industrial R&D development set up with Bruker in Europe. In parallel to this, there are collaborations being set up or already defined with various universities to study and to measure the outcome of this R&D in the different areas. And then very important is there's also a new US DOE magnet development program, a new effort that is being brought up now, and this will include a US activity with industry and labs also in the same area. Then for the magnet design, there is a European program that is called EuroCircle on 16 Tesla dipole design. There are 16 partner institutes. This program is supporting the Hadron Collider design with various work packages, one of which is the 16 Tesla magnets. And the options that are being considered by EuroCircle are the three types, cosinus theta blocks and common coils. And this program is complemented by a special Swiss contribution via PSI aiming at the canted cosine theta magnet. And then we hope, once the designs and the studies of these options is advanced well enough, that we can do a down selection by the end of 2016 for a more detailed design work to come up with the production folder for 16 Tesla models. Now, here very briefly just to mention that 16 Tesla field level based on niobium-13 has been achieved previously at CERN and at LBNL already in the years 2004 and recently at CERN. And from these various attempts, we also see that the magnets with a bore, these are the unfilled circles on this graph, they reached slightly lower field level, so clearly indicating that some margin in all these definitions is needed. So this is a summary of this 16 Tesla program planning. I will not go into detail because of lack of time, and I mentioned already the main ingredients. But we have a coherent plan, I think, until 2025 that finishes by then with the construction of models, and it is then going further with industrialization of these efforts. Now, let me very briefly mention also the US program. DOE US Magnet Development Program is coming up now and has four main goals that are all very relevant for the future circular collider studies. So I just mentioned what is here under goal number one. This is the design of 16 Tesla magnets, and in particular is mentioned cosine theta dipole design and the canted cosine theta design. And under goal number four, there is explicit mention the further development with industry of niobium 13 wire. So now, very briefly on the synchrotron radiation, I told you this is a problem for such a machine because a lot of heat is deposited in the middle of the machine, and therefore we need to extract this heat, and for this we are building a vacuum chamber inside the vacuum chamber that will stop these photons, the synchrotron radiation photons, that allow us to extract these photons at a higher temperature than the magnet temperature itself. In our case, we are looking into extracting at about 50 Kelvin this heat deposited in the middle of the 1.9 Kelvin cold mass magnets. And this is very important, which you can see from this slide here that shows you that the power on the vertical axis, the power that we need on the cryogenic system for cooling of the complete magnet system as a function, these curves are a function of the temperature of this beam screen that is capturing the synchrotron radiation. And you see, if we would work at low temperatures, we would need gigawatt of power, which is completely excluded, so we have to go to relatively high temperatures in the beam screen inserted in the magnet aperture. Related to this, we're also looking into even higher systems that would allow even higher temperatures and lower resistance for the beam image current, and this could be, for example, HDS coatings on such a beam screens that are being studied in the two collaboration explicitly. A few words on the detector concepts, because this is also a very important area for such a collider. We want to reach very high energies, so also the particles that are created in the collisions have high energies, and they need to be measured in a large detector. And to identify the momentum of charged particles, we want the magnetic field. So we need a means to have very large magnetic fields in a very large volume. And this is a concept that is scaled from the LHC. It's a 7,000 ton magnet, length 64 meter, diameter 30 meter, stored energy 50 gigajoule. And of course, this is very large. So now we are working on physics performing, cost efficient, much smaller variants. And here you see the present baseline, which is a solenoid based magnet, not shielded, 10 meters bore, 20 meters long. So this is becoming much more compact. Of course, it's a complicated optimization process because it involves also the different physics people and the different detector technologies that are associated with particle detection. I would also like to briefly mention one important concept. This is the concept of links, superconducting links for powering these machines. Here you see an example what is developed for the HLLHC. On the left side, this cable, this superconducting cable, will have a diameter of 65 millimeter. It will carry in total 150 kiloamps of current for several different magnet circuits. And of course, it's very promising for the FCC, where we have much larger distances, we have much deeper shafts, and we need to transport and power the different circuits. So it's a very promising concept that we want to follow in much more detail. And now here, very briefly, another new concept that we are investigating. This is a superconducting shield, SUSHI concept. We would, when we extract the beam from the accelerator, we have to take the circulating beam out by switching on a very high magnetic field on a short time. And here we would like to generate a very high field and zero field in one accelerator magnet. And here you can imagine, this is the lower picture in the middle, a 3 to 5 Tesla magnet sitting there. And before you power the magnet, you bring in a superconducting shield. When you power the magnet and the shield is superconducting, the shielding currents will prohibit the field from entering, so we'll have a field-free region in the middle of our magnet. And then a small displacement of the beam from the inside to the outside has the desired effect. Now, due to lack of time, I will not go into the smaller lepton collider. I've just put here the slides that are giving the basic parameters. The main interest on the lepton collider side is for the superconducting RF system, and there is a major design effort that is being done to look into the different cavities for the different working points with different technologies. The, let's say, long-term interest and R&D that we are following a little bit or trying to starting is on niobium 3 tin type components that would bring a huge step in overall efficiency. I will also skip that slide, and I will finish with just a statement on the collaboration. This work is based on a collaboration. The whole FCC is now formed by 88 institutes from 28 countries. So here is the list of all participating institutes. And I come to the summary. Superconductivity is clearly key enabling technology for future circular colliders in many areas, in particular the niobium 3 tin program towards 16 Tesla dipoles is of prime importance for the feasibility and cost of this machine. And at the same time, I want to stress that international collaboration is absolutely essential, because you saw the dimensions of such a project. This cannot be handled by single laboratories. It's essential that all the community is working together, and I would warmly like to invite you at this occasion to join the collaboration and to contribute to this FCC design. Also, I should remind you that the HLLHC is for us a very important first step in the direction of future circular colliders. And I hope that I could make you interested in this study. So our next milestone will be the FCC Week 2017 in Berlin, where we will review basic choices and the baseline design. And thank you for your attention. And I would be very happy to see you at our yearly conference in May, end of May 2017 in Berlin. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mike. Before going to Q&A, I would like to mention this talk was sponsored by Bruker ESC. Okay, a few questions, probably. Go ahead.
I had a question.
You have to see two aspects here. One is the development of the accelerator technology, detection technology, that is, of course, completely site independent. And the site selection to this project here is introduced, or the studies that we are doing presently is simply introduced by the European strategy, and the fact that CERN is in the position to provide such a basic injector infrastructure.
Thank you for an outstanding talk. When you talked about the future circular collider at CERN, you gave two examples, one with only LTS and one with some portion of HTS. The total mass of the conductors was the same, 10,000 in both. Was that small reduction in diameter worth it, or are there other advantages if HTS were actually to be used?
No, this estimate, we see the baseline route at the moment, as I said, is the niobium 3 tin. The possibility of higher magnetic fields, 20 Tesla in sort of hybrid configurations, is, I believe, a much longer term route that will require much more developments until we can prove the feasibility of these magnets. So it's purely for referencing and for comparison at this stage, but the baseline is the niobium 3 tin version.
Thank you for this outstanding talk. I have a question about another field which is covered by the conference but wasn't covered in your talk, and this is the field of detectors. you will have extremely large power in your system, and the semiconductor detectors may be replaced by some superconducting detectors. Can you comment on this?
At this stage, we have the detector concepts in a very early phase. Yeah. And we will not do any technological detector developments in the FCC study. Here I come back to the HLLHC project. What I did not mention was that for the high luminosity LHC project, there is associated a very massive and large upgrade of the whole detectors. And the detectors are, of course, very similar in their functional specifications to what we need here. So any FCC detector development on the technological side, for example, as you mentioned, silicon detectors via other detectors, will only be launched once the HLLHC phase two detector upgrade is completely done. Because it's the same community, it's the same people. We have to focus on the HLLHC detectors and then build on that results for the FCC.
Maybe last question? Or if not, let's thank speaker again.